Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. In this video, I am going to discuss the solutions to the Electronic Science June 2012 Electronic Science Paper 2. Okay, so hopefully if you are preparing for the UGC NET, that is so in the specific stream called Electronic Science, then you should know the questions which were asked in the previous year papers. So I am going to discuss the Paper 2 of Electronic Science, which was asked in June 2012. Okay, if you really like the video, please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel, and write down your comments below in the comment section. We basically are waiting for your positive feedback. Now let's have a look at the first question which was asked in the paper 2. In a JFET, the change in the drain current is due to the applied electric field between source and drain, electric field between gate and source, magnetic field between source and drain, magnetic field between gate and source. So answer to this is obviously B. So B is the answer to this question. Why? Because as you can see that the change in the drain current, IDS formula basically is equal to IDS is equal to IDS is 1 minus VGS by VP whole square. So the electric field is basically proportional to VGS. Okay, that's why the electric field is only responsible for the change in the drain current applied to, okay. Let's have a look at the next question. The increase in the temperature, the electrical conductivity would increase in metals as well as increase in semiconductors, increase in metals but decrease in semiconductors. So I just want to bring to your notice that metals have PTC of resistance, while semiconductors have NTC of resistance. Okay, I also want to bring to your notice that if we are talking about the extrinsic semiconductors, the conductivity first increases with temperature, and after 300 Kelvin it starts decreasing with the temperature. So if you know the plot with say conductivity with the temperature, for an extrinsic semiconductor it first increases up to a 300 Kelvin and then it starts decreasing, and that is up to the Curie temperature. Okay, that is up to the Curie temperature. But in general, for this particular question, metals have PTC of resistance, which means that with the temperature, PTC of resistance. Okay, semiconductors have NTC of resistance. Okay, so answer to this question is basically C, because with the increase in temperature, there will be a decrease in conductivity in metals and increase in conductivity in semiconductors. So answer C will be the correct option. Let's have a look at the next question. The network contains only independent current sources and resistors. If the values of the resistors are doubled, then the value of the node voltages will become half, will remain unchanged, will become double, cannot be determined unless circuit configuration and values of the resistor are known. Yes, D option suits better here, because unless we know the circuit diagram, unless we know the possible combinations in the particular circuit, and if we are not talking stating this thing in general, then we cannot say by just increasing the resistors to their double values, we cannot predict that there will be a corresponding change in one of these parameters. So this cannot be predicted, this cannot be determined unless the circuit configuration values of the resistors are known. So we cannot predict it. So D option suits good. Now the fourth question says, Thevenin's theorem replaces a complicated circuit facing a load by N. So we are talking of the Thevenin theorem. So Thevenin theorem, we find out the Thevenin voltage and Thevenin resistance across the load resistance RL. So Thevenin resistance, if we are talking about the Thevenin equivalent circuit, this is your VTH, this is your RTH, and this is basically across the load resistance RL. Okay, so in this case, as you can see that the fourth option, which is the D option, suits good. Ideal voltage source in series with resistor. So D option is correct. Don't confuse it with the don't confuse it to the B option. B option is true for Norton's theorem. Okay, had Norton theorem been asked in the question, then the option would have been the correct answer. Okay, but it is asking for the Thevenin theorem, so ideal voltage source in series with RTH. Okay, now let's go to the fifth question. When op amp is used as an integrator, the feedback element is resistor, capacitor, zener diode, voltage divider. Answer is capacitor. If we are talking of the integrator, an integrator is basically but a low pass filter. So if we draw it using an op amp, so this is a negative feedback op amp, and if we are doing a low pass filter, this is your VI, this is your R, this is your capacitor, this is basically this is a capacitor C. So feedback element here, as you can see, is your capacitor. So capacitor is basically acting as a feedback element. Okay, this is basically an ideal integrator. Okay, ideal integrator, this is your integrator. Differentiator, had it been asked to determine for the differentiator, the differentiator circuit looks something like this. This is your differentiator. Okay, this is your differentiator, and this is basically your ideal differentiator. Okay, so in that case, resistor R would have been the feedback element, and this is your integrator. So answer to this is integrator. So B is option is correct, which is basically your capacitor. Let's look at the sixth question. The output voltage VO of the ideal op amp circuit shown in the figure is what? So in this case, since it is a negative feedback, so the difference voltage is very, very small. Hence, the op amp is operating in the linear region. So we can apply the virtual short concept. Let's find out the voltage A. Let's say this node voltage is VA. So we apply the KCL, we get 0 minus VA upon 1K is equal to VA minus 0 upon 1K. This cancels. We get VA as 0 volts. So the voltage here is 0. So the voltage also 0 volt also appears here. So we apply the KCL. Now KCL, let's say this is node B. KCL at node B. So we apply, you get 0 minus, let's say this node voltage is equal to VB. So we can say that VA is equal to VB is equal to 0. So 2 minus VB upon 1K is equal to VB minus VO upon 5K. This implies that 2 is equal to VB 0 minus VO by 5. So we get VO as minus 10 volt. So answer to this will be A. So A option is correct. Let's look at the seventh question. How many flip-flops are required to build a binary counter circuit to account from 0 to 1023? So there are total of 1024 counts from 0 to 1023. So there are total of 0 to 1024 counts. So we know that number of flip-flops required is basically less than or equal to 2 to the power n. So here in this case, option C suits good. Number of flip-flops required is 10. Okay. Because number of states is basically equal to 2 to the power 10, so it will be equal to n less than equal to 1024. So number of flip-flops, if there are 10 flip-flops, the possible number of states that we can achieve is 1024 states from 0 to 1023. So total of flip-flops required is 10. So C is the answer. Now, among the following, the slowest ADC, analog to digital converter, is what? Parallel comparator, which is a flash type. Flash type is the fastest. Flash type ADC is the fastest, which only takes one clock cycle. Okay. Flash type ADC is basically only take one clock cycle. Successive approximation type, integrating type, and counting type. Counter type takes basically 2 to the power n minus 1 TCLK cycles. Okay. Integrating type and successive approximation, it's a successive SAR type ADC. Takes n clock cycles. While integrated duals, had it been a dual slope integrating type, so it would have been the slowest ADC among these. But integrating type is faster than successive approximation resistor type ADC. So B option here suits good. Okay, B option is correct. So among these options, SAR type ADC is the slowest. In a microcomputer, weight states are used to make the processor wait during a DMA operation. No, this is wrong. Make the processor wait during a power interrupt processing. No, this is also wrong. Make the processor wait during the power shutdown, which is also wrong. Interface slow peripherals to the processor. Yes, this is correct. D option is correct. So wait states are basically are those extra time which is required by the processor. So that in that duration your slow peripherals act. Okay, there's some so there's some peripherals connected to the processor which are slow, so they require some time to operate properly. So that's why wait states are incorporated in the processing. So D option is the correct answer. In a microprocessor, the register which holds the address of the next instruction is a program counter. Blindly, you have to basically tick mark the program counter as the correct answer. PC stores the address of the next instruction. PC stores the address of the next instruction. Okay? Next instruction. So, B option is the correct answer. Accumulator is just a register which does not store it. Stack pointer stores the address of the stack in the RAM. Okay, instructor register is also not correct. Program counter is correct, stores the address of the next instruction. Okay, 11th, consider the following structure: struct date, int day, int month, in year, struct data star pd. Which of the following is the correct method to refer to the year member? So here you can see that A option suits good. A option, this is how you basically refer any element of the structure above. Okay, A option is correct. Which of the following is not a linear data structure? Array, linked list, and stack all are basically your linear data structures. Tree is a non-linear data structure. Okay, let me just write the definition of a linear data structure. Linear data structure, for example, array, linked list, and queue are linear data structure because the elements are stored in a sequence. Okay, while non-linear data structure like tree or hash tree, data is stored non-linearly. Okay, so in this case your D option is correct. Tree is not a linear data structure. Okay, del square V minus rho V by epsilon. So if you had seen the video lectures on electromagnetics, you should have come across this particular equation. This equation represents a Poisson's equation. So C is the correct option. Had this term been zero, then the equation would have been del square V is equal to zero. This equation is known as a Laplace equation. Okay, this is a Laplace equation. Del square V is equal to minus rho V upon epsilon is basically a Poisson's equation. This is a Poisson's equation. So C is the correct answer. It's not a Gauss law, it's not a Laplace equation, it's not even a Maxwell's equation. So answer is Poisson's equation. The energy per unit volume per unit area transported by an electromagnetic field is what? We know that the average power density. So we know that this energy transferred it says the energy per unit time per unit area transported. So energy per unit time is what? Is the power, is basically P average divided by T. So energy is nothing but energy per unit time. So energy, you can say that energy per unit time per unit area. Energy per unit time per unit area is nothing but the pointing vector. Pointing vector, which is nothing but half mod E square by eta. Okay, this is the average power density, or you can say the average pointing vector. If we talk about the instantaneous pointing vector, which is represented by S vector, is nothing but E vector cross of H vector. Is nothing but the instantaneous pointing vector. And its unit is watts per unit area. Watts per unit area. So S vector, since it is equal to E vector cross of H vector, it becomes E vector cross of B vector divided by mu naught. So answer here comes out to be A. S vector is 1 by mu naught E vector cross of B vector. So answer A is correct. Now, this is the 15th question. Time division multiplexing can be used with PAM only, combines 5 group elements into subgroups, supergroups, stacks 24 channels in an adjacent frequency slots, interleaves pulses belonging to the different transmissions. So D's option is correct. It's a time division multiplexes. Multiplexing is basically the process of sending the samples from different streams on a channel. Okay, there are multiple signals, they are sampled individually, and then they are at particular a certain interval of time, they are basically sent over the channel. Okay, so interleave the pulses belonging to the different transmissions. So D is the correct option. 16th. One of the following types of noise becomes of great importance at the high frequencies. It is the short noise, random noise, impulse noise, or transit time noise. Let me discuss briefly about these type of noises which are present in the devices. Short noise is basically a time dependent fluctuation in the electrical current, which is caused by the discreteness of the electronic charge. Well known to occur in solid state devices such as tunnel junctions, Schottky barrier diodes, or PN junctions. So it's basically, that's what is referred to as short noise. Let me just write the basic definition of it. It's a time dependent fluctuations in electrical current caused by the discreteness of electronic charge. Okay, for example, well known to occur in solid state devices, SSDs, such as tunnel junction, Schottky diode, or PN junctions. So when basically the electrons cross the junction, they cross the junction, it traveling from emitter to the collector. Okay, when the electron reach through the different times. So when the electrons basically cross the junction, they reach at different time intervals. So that basically result into short noise. Okay, so there is no dependency of this noise over frequency. So the option A is incorrect. If we now talk of the random noise. Random noise is nothing but a white noise. Okay, it's basically a white noise. So it does not even depend on frequency, because if we just have a look at the power spread density of this noise, it's almost constant it's almost same for all the frequencies. So there is no frequency dependency. So B is also incorrect. If we talk of the impulse noise is also known as the burst noise. Okay, this is also known as a burst noise. Okay, this is basically an electronic noise that occurs in semiconductor and ultra thin gate oxide films, like sudden step like transistor between two or more discrete voltages or current levels. Sudden step like transitions between two or more discrete voltages or current levels. Okay, so as high as several hundred, so as high as hundreds of microvolt. So these are basically your impulse noise or the burst noise. So there is no dependency of this impulse noise over the frequency. So C's option is also incorrect. Now last one is basically your transit time noise. So we talk of the transit time noise. This basically happens when the time taken by the electrons to basically travel from the emitter to the collector becomes comparable to the period of the signal being amplified, that is at the frequencies above very high frequencies and beyond, so called the transit time effect takes place, and the noise input admittance of the transistor increases, and this is the result of the transit time noise. So if we keep on increasing the frequency above the VHF, we get the transit time noise, as so the transit time noise becomes prominent. So this noise becomes prominent at high frequencies. So it's of a great importance at the high frequencies. So D option is correct. So let me just write the basic definition of it. So if the time taken by the electron from emitter to the collector becomes comparable to the period of the signal being amplified that is at the frequencies above VHF frequency, very high frequencies, and beyond, so-called transit time effect takes place. Okay, and noise input admittance of the transistor increases, and this is basically the result of the transit time noise. So what happens is that when the electrons basically travel from the emitter to the collector, all the electrons do not reach at the same time. They arrive in the collector at different time instants. That basically leads to the transit time noise, and they are basically more prominent at the high frequencies. Okay, that's why D option is the correct answer. The 17th one is, a relaxation oscillator is one which oscillates continuously, has two stable states, relax indefinitely, produces non-sinusoidal output. This D option is the correct answer. Relaxation oscillator is basically used to produce non-sinusoidal repetitive or periodic signals like triangular signal or square signal. That's the main function of the relaxation oscillator, that it produces non-sinusoidal signals which are periodic, for example square wave, square pulse or square wave or triangular wave. So this is the function of a relaxation oscillator. So D option is the correct answer. A transducer which generates electrical power. Electrical power is generated by a solar cell. Okay, C is the correct answer. It is generated by a solar cell. A step index monomode fiber has a diameter less than equal to 10 micrometer, 50 micrometer, 100 micrometer, 200 micrometer. A step index monomode, we are just talking about the core of the fiber. Okay, we are talking about the core of the fiber. So A is the answer. It is basically less than or equal to 10 micrometer. If we are talking about the cladding, the diameter is about 120 micrometer. Okay, the cladding is about 120 micrometer, while core is about less than or equal to 10 micrometer. Okay, so A is the correct option. Which control system has hysteresis property? On-off controller, property control, proportional controller, integral controller, PID controller. Answer is A. Only on-off controller possesses a hysteresis property. Okay. Now this is basically your there's some question 21 to 30 are basically your statement type question, assertion reason type question. So just have a look at these options. So one of these options is correct. Now let's have a look at 21st question. If a semiconductor is placed in a transverse magnetic field B and electric field E is applied across its other two faces, then it would produce an electric current I in the direction perpendicular to the B and E. This is nothing but your Hall experiment. This is nothing but your Hall experiment. Okay, which is correct. Hall coefficient is proportional to the mobility of the charge carriers in the semiconductor. We know mu is equal to 8 upon 3 pi sigma RH. So we can say that RH is proportional to the mobility of the charge carriers. Both the statements are basically true, but R is not the correct explanation to assertion. So option B is correct. Option B is correct. Both are true, but R is not the correct explanation of A. Let's have a look at the 22nd question. The voltage current characteristics of a tunnel diode exhibits dynamic negative resistance region, which is correct. Assertion is correct. So the negative resistance occurs, therefore tunnel diode behaves as a low power oscillating device. So this is also correct, and R basically is the correct explanation of A. So answer to this is A. A option is correct. Both are true, and R is the correct explanation to A. So here you can see true, but R is the correct explanation of A. So A option is correct. 23rd, the R to a ladder type DAC converter has a higher speed of conversion than a weighted resistance D to A converter. So this statement is true. It is faster than the weighted resistance type DAC. R to a ladder type DAC converter uses smaller number of components than the weighted. This is not the correct explanation, which is incorrect. This is incorrect. The statement is not correct. Okay. So both R to one and weighted resistance DAC type converter have the same number, comparable number of resistors or other elements in the circuitry. So this does not basically explains this reason. R does not basically explains your assertion. So answer C or C option is correct, where A is true and D is reason R is incorrect. This is not the correct explanation. So C is correct answer. 24th, a processor can reference a memory stack without specifying an address. Okay, which is correct. A processor can reference a memory stack without specifying an address. This is correct. The address is always available and automatically updated in the stack pointer, which is correct. So A option is correct, which means that R is the correct explanation of A. The path of root locus on a real axis is not dependent upon the poles and zeros which are not on the real axis, which is true. The root locus does not depend upon the poles and zeros which are not present on the real axis, because the poles and zeros which do not exist on the real axis exist in the conjugate pairs. So which is correct answer. So A option is correct. So reason is the correct explanation of A. The top-down structured programming should be used for developing a program, which is of course required by the programmers to write the programs in a top-down format. So in order to improve the credibility of the code, okay, the top-down structured programming methodology enables us to get readable and easily provable program, which is correct. So A option is correct. Okay, stimulated emission is the key to operation of laser. An important property of which is correct. Stimulated emission of a key of operation is for laser, which is correct. An important property of a laser radiation is its coherence, under which is meant the correlation between the phase of oscillation at different positions in space at various moments of time. A is the correct option. And a half adder is faster than full adder. Yes, it is true. It is true. A half adder gives only one output while a full adder gives two output, which is wrong. This is false. So option C is correct. A half adder also gives two outputs, so it's sum and carry. Your full adder also gives two outputs, sum and carry. So we cannot say that a half adder only gives one output. That's why it is faster than the full adder, which is not correct. So C is the correct answer. A programmable read-only memory can be used as a synchronous counter, which is correct. Okay. Each memory location of a programmable read-only memory is programmed and can be read synchronously, which is wrong. So answer to this question is C. Okay. In PCM, a message signal is represented by a sequence of coded pulses, which is accomplished by representing a signal in the discrete form in both time and this thing, amplitude, which is correct. True. Signal encoded in the form of a quantized samples, which translates into a coded number, which is also correct. So A option is correct answer. R, reason R, is the correct explanation of the assertion made. Now, let's have a look at the next question, which is 31st question. Configuration of consider the following circuit configurations. Common emitter, common base, emitter follower, which is also known as the common collector, common emitter follower using Darlington pair. The correct sequence in the increasing order of the input resistances of these configurations is what? Okay. Common emitter, we just talk of the common emitter, its input resistance is nothing but HIE, which is a smaller value. Okay. Common base, if we just talk of the common base, has an input resistance of HIE by divided by 1 plus HFE, which is a very small value because common base acts as a current amplifier, which has a very low input resistance. If we just talk about the emitter follower is nothing but a common collector, which is nothing but your emitter follower. Okay, emitter follower has input resistance of HIE plus 1 plus HFE into RE, which is a very high value. RE is nothing but your output resistance. This is your output resistance. And we just talk about the emitter follower common collector Darlington pair. Your Darlington pair is basically a cascade of two common collector amplifiers. So you can see this is what called as a Darlington pair. This is your Darlington pair. Its input resistance is quite high. The Darlington pair has an input resistance, a very high input resistance as compared to the other three. Okay. As you can see, for a single stage common collector amplifier, your input resistance is HIE plus 1 plus HFE into output resistance, which appears across this thing. So you can see that RE basically appears here, and input resistance is quite a big number as compared to the single stage common collector amplifier. So the sequence from of these configurations, the correct sequence, the increasing order of the sequence. So increasing order, the first one will obviously common base amplifier. Common base amplifier has the smallest input resistance. Then we have the common emitter amplifier. So first one is 2, then 1. Then we have 3, which is basically emitter follower, which is common collector. And the fourth one has the highest input resistance. So option C basically matches our explanation. Okay. 32. Digital measuring instruments use the following types of analog to digital converters: dual slope type, counter type, and flash type. The correct sequence of these converters in decreasing order of their speed. So dual slope integrated type is the slowest of all. It takes 2 to the power n plus 1 clock cycles. Okay. Is the slowest of all. Counter type ADC is basically takes 2 to the power n minus 1 clock cycles. Okay. Then your flash type ADC only take 1 clock cycle. So in the converters in decreasing order of their speed. So first one will be your 3, which is flash type ADC. Then we will have your counter type ADC. Then we have dual slope integrated type ADC, which is a D option is correct. 3, 2, and 1. Okay. Now, Consider the following logic families: MOS, DTL, RTL, and ECL. MOS, the sequence of the logic families in the order of their increasing noise margin. MOS is MOSFET, okay, which is metal oxide semiconductors. MOS have basically about 1.5 volt of noise margin. This is a 1.5 volt of noise margin. Your DTL, diode transistor logic, has 0.7 volt of noise margin. ECL family has 0.3 volts of noise margin. And RTL, resistor transistor logic, has 0.2 volts of noise margin. So option B basically satisfies our explanation. So option B is correct. 3, 4, 2, 1. So fastest, so increasing of the noise margin, first one will be your RTL, then we will have your DTL, sorry, ECL, then we have DTL, then we have MOSFET. So 3, 4, 2, 1 is the correct answer. Consider the following optical communication system: FM broadcast, AM broadcast, microwave communication, optical fiber communication. The sequence of the communication systems in order of their increasing carrier frequency is what? The first one is will be your increasing small, the lowest frequency is AM broadcast, okay, this will be first. Then we will have FM broadcast, this is second. Then we have microwave communication, then we have optical fiber communication. So B option is the correct option. The highest data rate can be transmitted using the following cables: coaxial cable, twisted wire cable, optical fiber cable. The correct sequence of the increasing order, the correct sequence in increasing order. So highest data rate is achieved by the optical fiber cable. Optical fiber basically have highest, the transmission can achieve highest data rate when transmitted through optical fibers, optical fiber cables. So answer to this will be 35 will be your, so in the increasing order, increasing slowest to the largest. So slowest is basically a twisted wire cable. So this will come first. Then we have a coaxial cable. Then we have the twisted optical fiber. So answer to this is basically C. C option satisfies our explanation. This is the match the following. So laser, solar cell, photodiode, LED. Okay. Laser basically stimulated emission. Okay. Laser has the stimulated emission. Solar cell delivers power to the load. So this is B. Photodiode is basically has spontaneous emission or consumes electrical power due to the incident light. So C option. So two will be basically, two is matched to the photodiode. Photodiode is matched to the second option. LED is spontaneous emission. Okay. So the option C basically satisfies our explanation. Okay. So laser basically has stimulated emission. Solar cell delivers power to the load. Photodiode consumes electrical power to the incident light. And LEDs provide spontaneous emission. C option is the correct option. Now this is list one: BJT, FET, SCR, and tunnel diode. BJT will be matched to pinch off effect or controlled rectification, negative resistance, or punch through effect. So BJT is matched to the punch through effect when the collector junction is reverse biased, or you can say when the BJT is operated in the active region, and when we basically increase the reverse bias voltage across the collector junction, the depletion region, the collector, the base collector depletion region increases in size with the increase in the reverse bias voltage, and the penetration of the depletion region is more in the base region. And at a particular voltage, when the depletion region of the collector junction touches the edge of the depletion region of emitter base junction, then the punch through will take place. If we further increase the voltage, the punch through takes place, and this damages the device. So BJT, the punch through phenomena takes place in the BJT when the reverse bias voltage across the base collector junction is increased beyond a certain limit. Okay. FET, field effect transistors, pinch off effect takes place. So B will basically be matched to 1. Pinch off effect. So B. Okay. Pinch off effect takes place when your FET, field effect transistors, enters into a saturation region. The channel basically tapers and its shapes basically turns out to be a ramp. Okay. And if you further increase the VDS, if you further increase your VDS, the pinch off of the channel takes place. Increase in the VDS tapers the channel. Okay. And the pinch off effect takes place. So B will be matched to 1. SCR is silicon controlled rectifier. SCR is silicon controlled rectifier. It's a three channel, it's basically a thyristor. It's a thyristor. So it provides a controlled rectification. So C is matched to 2. And tunnel diode has a property called negative resistance characteristics. Tunnel diode basically possesses negative resistance characteristics. So answer to this will be C. C matches our explanation. Ampere's law, Biot-Savart law, Coulomb's law, Gauss law. Okay, Ampere's law is related to magnetic flux density at a point. So A is matched to 4. Biot-Savart law, force due to the current carrying conductor. So B is basically matched to 2. Okay, Coulomb's law is force on a charge. C is matched to 1. And Gauss law says it is related to electric flux density at a point. So D is matched to 3. So option B basically satisfies our explanation. Next question. Parallel comparators, successive approximation, dual slope and then counter type. Parallel comparator is basically matched to fastest converter. Parallel comparator, or you can say it's a flash type converter. Parallel comparator or a flash type, ADC. So it's the fastest, or you can say it's a flash type ADC. Okay. So A is basically matched to 2. Successive approximation type ADC. Successive approximation register type ADC. It's basically matched to N-bit conversion time. SAR type ADC has N-bit conversion time, N clock cycles. Dual slope. Dual slope is basically your integrating type. Okay. Dual slope is integrating type. And then we have a counter type ADC, which is voltage dependent conversion type. So D is matched to 3. So option B basically satisfies our explanation. Option B satisfies our explanation. 40th question. Frequency modulation, double sideband suppressed signal carrier, PCM amplitude modulation. Frequency modulation is basically related to the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis. Okay, so A is matched to 4. Double side carry double sideband suppressed signal carrier is basically related to the balanced modulator. Balanced modulator is used to generate the DSB signal. So B is related to 3. PCM, pulse code modulation, is related to companioning or expanding. Okay, C is related to 2. An amplitude modulation is envelope detector. We can detect the signals using the envelope detector. We can detect the amplitude modulated signal using envelope detection method. So the option D satisfies our explanation. Okay. LVDT, bourbon tube, strain gauge, thermistor. Option D basically satisfies our explanation. Option D is correct. LVDT is related to 3, displacement. Your burden tube is related to pressure. Strain gauge is related to stress. And thermistor is related to temperature. Okay. So D option is correct. Now, this is sine flag parity, zero or auxiliary carry. So we just basically draw the flag resistor S, Z, X, A, C, X, P, X, C, Y. Okay. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This is a flag register. Okay. This is basically an 8-bit register. or a 1 byte register. So from here you can see that sign flag occurs at the 7th bit. So A is matched to 4. Parity is connected to 2, is 2nd bit. So B is connected to 3. Zero is connected to 6th bit. So C is related to 2. And auxiliary carry, which is AC, is related to 4th bit position. So D is matched to 4. So the option B satisfies our explanation. Okay. Let's move to the next question. Gun diode, solar cell, MOSFET or SCR. Gun diode is nothing but your gallium arsenide, which is basically referred to as a junctionless device, which is also referred to as a junctionless device. This diode does not have any junction. The only gun effect takes place in this diode. Gallium arsenide is junctionless diode. That's why the carriers which are present in the gallium arsenide are also referred to as hot carriers, because of the absence of the junction. So A is basically matched to junctionless device. Solar cell is basically a PN junction diode. Is normally a PN junction diode. So you can say it's a single junction device. So B is matched to 2. Okay. MOSFET. MOSFET is a double junction device. C is connected to, because there are two junctions. One between the source and the substrate. Another one is between the drain and the substrate. So it's basically a double junction device. SCR is basically your silicon controlled rectifier. Silicon controlled rectifier. Silicon controlled rectifier, or it is also referred to as a thyristor. Thyristor has three junctions. So that's why it is also referred to as a triple junction device or a thyristor. So D is correct. So C option basically satisfies our explanation. We have then monostable multivibrator, astable multivibrator, Schmitt trigger, bistable multivibrator. Okay, monostable battery, as from the name, it's quite tacit from the name itself that it has only one stable state. So A is mapped to 2. Astable multivibrator, which it's quite tacit from the name itself that it does not have any stable state. So it oscillates between the two states, two quasi-stable states. So B is related to 1. B is mapped to 1. It has a two quasi-stable states. Okay. Schmitt trigger has how many? Schmitt trigger basically has two stable states. Schmitt trigger has two stable states. There's a correction. Your ASRO multivibrator, from the name itself, it's quite tacit that it does not have any stable state. So B option is mapped to 4. Okay. Schmitt trigger has only quasi-stable states because the Schmitt trigger, as you can see, the output waveform basically oscillates between the two states. It does not have any stable states. So there are two quasi-stable states. Okay. So from here you can see that Schmitt trigger is basically mapped to 1. The C is mapped to this. Monostable states has only one stable state. So A is correct here. So A, monostable multivibrator, as from the name itself, is quite tacit that it has only one stable state. So A is mapped to 2. A stable multivibrator does not have any stable state, so it is mapped to 4. Schmitt trigger has only quasi stable states. There are only quasi stable states because the output waveform oscillates between the two states, which are the quasi stable states. So C is mapped to 1. And bistable multivibrator has two stable states, either 0 or 1. So D is mapped to 3. So the option B satisfies our explanation. Okay. 45th, semiconductor memory, ferrite core memory, magnetic tape memory, flash memory. So semiconductor memory is a combination logic, is mapped to the combination logic. Ferrite core memory is mapped to the destructive readout. Okay. And magnetic tape memory, it is non-volatile. C is mapped to 3. And flash memory is nothing but your EEPROM. Okay. So the option A satisfies our explanation. So option A is correct. So this is from 46 to 50 is basically the question. 40 questions from 46 to 50 are based on this paragraph which is given here. So please go through this paragraph once and then hop on to the questions which are based on this paragraph. Okay, in a communication system, noise is most likely to affect the signal at the transmitter, in a channel, or in the information source, or at the destination. Of course, in the channel, noise only affects the signal at in the channel. When the signal is transmitted, you can see that at the output you get some signal, you get a distorted signal because of the additive white Gaussian noise, AWGN noise. Okay, indicate the false statement. HF high frequency mixers are generally noisier than the high frequency amplifiers. So we have to basically select the false statement, okay, which is true. Okay, HF mixers are generally noisier than the HF amplifiers. Impulse noise voltage is independent of the bandwidth, which is wrong, which is false. Impulse noise is also dependent upon the bandwidth. Okay, thermal noise is independent of the frequency at which it is measured. Yes, it is independent of that, which is true, because power spectral density is uniformly distributed from minus infinity to infinity. Okay, so it is basically the power spectral density of this thermal noise is constant for all the frequencies. Okay, so it is true. Industrial noise is usually of the impulse type. Yes, it's basically a burst noise or industrial noise, or you can say an impulse noise. This is also basically an impulse noise or burst noise. A sudden burst of sound is what referred to as an industrial noise. So that's basically is usually of an impulse type. So answer B, option B, satisfies our explanation. So option B is correct. Of the value of a resistor creating thermal noise is doubled, the noise power generated is therefore remains unchanged. It does not have any effect on the thermal, on the noise power. It does not have any effect on the noise power. It does have effect on the signal power, but it does not have any effect on the noise power. So the signal power depends on the resistor, but noise power does not. Okay, one of the following is not a useful quantity for comparing the noise performance of the receivers: input noise voltage, equivalent noise resistance, noise temperature. You have a noise figure. Noise figure is the a parameter which is used in determining the comparing the noise performance of the receivers. Yeah, so this is a wrong option. Noise temperature, it is also a wrong option, because noise temperature is also an important parameter in comparing the noise performance of the receivers. Equivalent noise resistance or noise input noise voltage, this is also a good, this is also an important parameter in determining, in comparing the noise performance of the receivers. So option A is the correct option. Input noise voltage cannot be used in comparing the noise performance of the receivers. So option A is correct. Let's move to the last question. Indicate the noise whose source is in the category whose source is in a category different from that of the other three: solar noise, cosmic noise, atmospheric noise, galactic noise. Solar noise occurs basically comes from the solar radiation. And this takes place outside the Earth. Cosmic noise and galactic noise also occur outside the earth. Okay, that occur outside the Earth. Atmospheric noise is the only noise which occurs inside the Earth's atmosphere. So the source of the atmospheric noise is within the Earth, and the source of the solar noise, cosmic noise, and galactic noise are the sources of solar noise, cosmic noise, and galactic noises are outside the Earth. So C option is the correct option. So C option is the correct option. That's all, folks. Hopefully you understood properly. Thank you very much.